इवनिंग प्रोफेसर धीमन, प्रोफेसर मिश्रा, मैडम फड़के, मैडम अग्रवाल एंड ऑल द डिग्निटरीज, फ्रेंड्स, कोलीग्स, स्टूडेंट्स. इट इज रियली एन ऑनर टू गिव दिस टॉक टुडे. आई रियली मिस बीइंग इन अमंगस्ट यू इन लखनऊ इन एसजीपीजे फिजिकली, बट बिकॉज ऑफ द कोविड सिचुएशन वी हैव टू डू दिस ऑनलाइन. Professor, I consider myself fortunate for getting an opportunity to meet Professor Agarwal several times. This photograph is taken in Manipal when he visited us in 2012, to where he was part of the launch of the Indian Society of Indian Academy of Medical Genetics. I revere him for importantly two qualities. One is his vision. When nobody dared to dream about genetics, he began the Department of Medical Genetics in India. And his conviction. For several years, he had to fight with the then Medical Council of India for recognition, which would not accept it as a super specialty degree. And I think it took nearly 15 years to get the accreditation by the Medical Council of India retrospectively. We are all having the fruits of his vision and conviction. We can see here now several medical geneticists trained by him directly or indirectly and spread throughout the country, and people no longer ask what is medical genetics. When nobody thought it is the right step, he was the only person to think medical genetics is the way forward. And now I think everybody agrees with this and they don't have to convince somebody. I thank Professor Fadke and her team for inviting me to give this talk in memory of Professor S.S. Agarwal. I'll be discussing Indian contributions to gene discovery. I have about 40 minutes and 40 slides. You can see the slide number in the right corner, so you can guess where I am. I'll be discussing in my talk, I'll be briefly introducing you to rare genetic diseases, the global scenario of gene discovery, and two personal gene discovery stories from our team. And then I will take you through review of Indian contributions to disease gene discovery and give some thoughts on what should be done to take this forward. Rare genetic disorders are defined as diseases with the prevalence of less than 1 in 2000 people. So this is the definition, but remember there are about 7,000 to 10,000 conditions. So if you see this rarity and number of conditions, almost 1 in every 10 of us have a rare disease. Incidentally, 70 to 80% of them are monogenic. Some are infections, some are autoimmune disorders, but mostly they are genetic and that too monogenic. When we say monogenic, we mean that phenotype is explained by genetic variation in a single gene to the most of its part. And in my today's talk, I'll be focusing only on monogenic diseases. If you see the online catalog called OMIM, Online Mendelian Inheritance in Man, it catalogs nearly 8,000 rare monogenic disorders for about 6,000 of them we have identified a genetic basis, and remaining 1,800 are just phenotypic description for which we need to identify the genetic basis. Rare diseases together contribute to very high mortality and morbidity in children. And we have been nicely introduced by Professor Dhiman that some diseases are now treatable, but currently 90% of them do not have an FDA approved drug. But last few years have seen that things are changing. Probably it is going to take a rapid pace in terms of treatment. If you look into Indian scenario, we have 1.35 billion people. And that means we have 10 crore people with rare disease, or 92 100 lakhs or 100 million, that is 10 crore people living with rare diseases in our country. Dr. Phadke has already mentioned Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has brought out national policy for rare diseases just recently, a couple of months ago, but this is just a drop in the ocean. In our efforts to improve the well-being and decrease the suffering of people and families with rare diseases. Sadly, 40% or more of them do not reach a diagnosis during their first medical visit. It is because medical people are not trained, and these diseases are so rare, expertise is so less. So many times they run from doctor to doctor in what we call diagnostic odyssey. It is about 5 years time which is taken for diagnosis on an average. It can sometimes be delayed up to 20 years, and it is not an easy step to make in the diagnosis and management. So several years are spent in the patient's lives before a diagnosis is made. So this is the Indian scenario. Now, I'll briefly introduce a few terms. What is disease gene identification? Okay, to tell it in simple words, disease gene identification is a process by which scientists identify mutations. Please note this word, mutations are defects in the genes responsible for a genetic disorder. I'm talking solely on monogenic disorders or Mendelian disorders or single gene disorders. We identified changes in one of the nearly 19,500 genes which is associated with a particular disease or phenotype or an illness in all the people who have mutation in that particular gene. If you go to the dictionary, discovery means the act of finding something that had not been known before, finding something new. In simple words, in medical in medical curriculum, I like this definition. What is not written in the textbooks, what is not mentioned in the OMIM, what is not mentioned in the medical literature, mostly in PubMed, if you find something new, that is nothing but discovery. So if you identify a disease and its genetic basis, which is not already listed, it is called disease gene discovery or identification. That is the topic of my presentation today. Why is this discovery critical? Why should we discover? See, we traditionally, we are all teachers, or we were students. We continue to be students throughout our life, as it has already been mentioned about the quality of Professor S.S. Agarwal. Discovery is like creating new knowledge, right? It is nothing but research where we identify new diseases which is not known. Diagnosis is using the existing knowledge, and you take training to make diagnosis when the knowledge is already there, okay, which is also called imparting existing knowledge. Creating new knowledge is research, imparting existing knowledge is training, which enables diagnosis. The ultimate aim of both discovery and diagnosis is to bring them into practice, where we treat patients, we counsel, we offer prenatal diagnosis, we enable better living for patients affected with rare diseases and monogenic disorders. Now, I will show you the global scenario of rare disease gene discovery. There are four graphs. One is A, B, C, D. I'll take you through these graphs very slowly, and I would like you to follow this. See, the blue line or light green line you can see here, this is the olden strategy for discovery of rare genetic diseases. Mostly people describe the phenotype, then slowly positional cloning came into picture and genetic basis of diseases were identified. But then you see the monogenic condition had the advantage of newer technologies slowly taking over gene discovery. And finally, when the next generation sequencing or exome sequencing came, the pace at which genes were discovered, conditions were phenotyped, increased dramatically. You can also see in the graph B, in red graph, we see gene discoveries based on traditional methods, and you can see the blue lines indicate how rapidly next generation sequencing in the form of mostly exome sequencing has increased the pace of discovery of rare disease genes. This is, the graph is just to show de novo conditions, autosomal dominant condition, autosomal recessive condition, and rare X-linked conditions, and their frequency or the rate at which they are discovered. And you can see here the contribution of next generation sequencing versus the delineation of the phenotype. It was earlier it was clinical skill. Now we delineate phenotype and genotype simultaneously. So the orange colored graph show delineation of syndromes or condition based on the phenotype, and the blue graph show that these genes and conditions are described simultaneously, which is the current trend where we describe new genes and their associated phenotype simultaneously. I just wanted you to understand the last 10 years, nearly 3,000 genes and the diseases caused by them have been linked. So that means around 300 new disease genes are discovered every year. Coming to India, why are we specially placed in a good position now for gene hunting? Okay, why is India a treasure for gene hunting? One, here I would say the population is our strength. We have any disease, we have any number of patients. So the material for research is so immense, but it also increases the burden of socioeconomic burden of these illnesses on our state as well as the people. So this gives us the opportunity to map rare diseases. We, as you know, we have 4,500 anthropologically defined groups. So we have so many religions, castes, subcastes, groups, tribals, and which have undergone several bottlenecks and founder effects, which precipitate recessive diseases. High level of endogamy or consanguinity to the rate of up to 45% is seen in several communities. We may say that in North or in certain part of our country, we don't marry a relative, we don't marry in Gotra. But remember, we always, traditionally, for the centuries, we select our partner from the same religion, same caste, same community. So this actually has precipitated several founder effects and several consanguineous disorders. So very rare recessive disorders can be precipitated by the level of inbreeding, consanguinity, and population structure in India, which is almost similar to the Middle East. Now we have increased manpower and resources, which puts us in a better position to identify new diseases and the disease-causing genes. I will now show you two examples where we identified new diseases from the patients we have seen in the clinic. Every gene discovery is a story by the team which discovered it. So if we have 20 new disease genes, we have 20 stories to tell. But I think it is true for all the people who are watching, who are listening to this lecture. They also have similar stories to tell when they identify new diseases, new mutations, new phenotypes. But because of the, to keep it short, I have taken two examples to illustrate how Indian population structure empowered us to make the new discovery of two monogenic conditions. This was the family which I saw where they consulted us for prenatal diagnosis in their fifth pregnancy. They had lost, the couple had lost two children, one at the age of 2 years, second one at the age of 5 years. Both had developmental delay, slowly neuroregression, seizures, spasticity, elevated creatine phosphokinase. She was 39 and she had 4 cesarean sections. My friend, with a gynecologist, he said, "Girish, if you can do prenatal diagnosis, I am ready to take the care of this lady who was desperate to have a baby." Because 4 cesarean, some of the gynecologists said this is high time that you should not continue this pregnancy. We already have 4 scars on your abdomen and uterus. But my obstetrician friend, he said, if you do prenatal diagnosis, they want to have a baby, but we did not have a diagnosis. Now, we looked into the MRI of the second child, which showed pachygyria. If you can see here, there are these arrowheads show pachygyria, and moderate dilatation of ventricles, diffuse T2 hyperintensity in the cerebral and cerebellar white matter. Both places there was white matter abnormalities, and even in the posterior limb of internal capsule. MR spectroscopy showed elevated lipid lactate levels, which suggested we might be seeing a white matter disease, which is obvious here, or a mitochondrial disease because lactate was high, or you know, congenital muscular dystrophy can present like this. It was just when next generation sequencing was available in our center. So what we did is, we did whole exome sequencing trio. Money was not the problem for the family who were affording, and we found no disease, no known disease. But what was surprising was, there was a very rare missense variant in ISCA1 gene, ISCA1 gene, which was identified in the homozygous state in the proband. You must see what I missed telling here is, the proband was not alive. Okay, proband had undergone a test at some other center. Luckily, that center had kept the DNA even for several years when they approached us. It was nearly 2 years when they approached us. Then we requested our colleague to send the DNA to us, which was very small in quantity, but we had no option. We went ahead with the exome sequencing. Luckily, it could be done, and we identified a rare variant. But we were not sure whether it is the correct diagnosis or not. We are looking for more evidences. If you do not have any scientific evidences to show that this is a disease-causing gene, you cannot offer a definitive prenatal diagnosis. Now, we confirmed it by Sanger validation. We identified the proband was homozygous, parents were heterozygous, and our bioinformatician immediately came saying that there is one more patient with the same variant, which would normally mean it is not disease-causing. But when we looked into the phenotype, we had about 100 patients who had undergone exome sequencing for neurodevelopmental disorder, and there was a second patient who had the same variant, who had developmental delay, seizures, and regression. And when we saw the MRI, picture was same. There was extensive leukodystrophy involving cerebral and cerebellar white matter, dilated ventricles, and MRS showed elevated lipid lactate peak, which made us that these two children have the same disease. The second family had the same variant and same clinical phenotype, suggesting this is a new disorder of mitochondrial gene, nuclear gene coding for mitochondrial protein. This variant was highly conserved among several species, and when we did the region of homozygosity analysis, both patients shared the same region of homozygosity around this variant, which meant they had probably common ancestry. They were from the same local community, but they could not trace, they could not tell us whether they were related or not. Now, if you see the pathway where ISCA1 plays a role, it is called iron sulfur biogenesis pathway in the mitochondria. Mitochondrial iron sulfur cluster assembly machinery has several proteins, and you can see here already NFU1 is associated with multiple mitochondrial dysfunction syndrome type 1, and you can see here BOLA3 in type 2, and one more here, IBA57 type 3, and type 4 was also already known in one of other genes. So we now had a protein which forms one of the integral component of iron sulfur biogenesis pathway, where already four different types of multiple mitochondrial dysfunction syndromes were known, is the possible cause in our patient. We reviewed type 1, 2, 3, 4 and our two families, and we came up with the proposal that this represents a new multiple mitochondrial dysfunction syndrome. We published this paper immediately, but slowly we started getting more patients with the same picture, same MRI picture. And we now have six families. One of them was detected by carrier testing. Anju diagnosed this condition by seeing their child's MRI. And then we had same mutation in all the families belonging to the same community, same group, in the same geographic location. And This is our paper which was published in Journal of Human Genetics in 2017. It was later indexed in OMIM as a new multiple mitochondrial dysfunction syndrome type 5, and several papers followed. But what was interesting is, we are showing here three families, all of them shared same regions of homozygosity, and they were from same geographic location of the Karnataka or northern Kerala, which suggests the high inbreeding in this part of our country and in this particular community. It is not just we enjoyed discovering a new disease. Even for the first family, we could do prenatal diagnosis. At that time, we were not really confident. Actually, the family said, please let us know whether that variant is present in the fetus or not. And with the rest of the things, we will leave it to the God. And luckily, the baby was unaffected and they had a healthy, beautiful daughter, even for the first family. Subsequent families also consulted us for counseling, and one of them, for sure, we did prenatal diagnosis. It is actually gratifying to see your discovery, your diagnosis makes an immediate impact to the family and your family which you have seen, and for other families in the country and across the globe. That is one of the most gratifying aspects of doing research. This is the second story. So we were referred a patient from Mumbai for short stature. She was short, otherwise she was non-syndromic. She was born to non-consanguineous couple. We identified the genetic defect, and then we saw there was a second patient with the same defect. This is a boy with short stature. Again, parents are non-consanguineous. He was also short. I will show you the radiographic picture. What was striking was, to make it simple, I am going to explain only few features. The vertebra was beak-like or pondyle with anterior beaking, and this is the normal spine at the age of 2 years, and you can see here this is abnormal. And even the older boy had less beaking, but it was again almost similar shape as that of the first one. It should be really like a rectangle. So this is abnormality which we noted in the spine. And then in the pelvis, what we observed was large epiphysis of femoral head, short femoral neck, which was present in both of them. Even hands and the rest of the radiogram showed similar findings. There was platyspondyle as well. In both of them, we observed a missense mutation in phosphatidyl serine decarboxylase enzyme or gene which codes for this, which was rare, found in only these patients, and it is likely to be predicted as disease causing or damaging to the protein function. We segregated in both families, and both families, we propose they have the same disease and same disease causing variant. You can see here, this variant is well conserved across several species, and protein modeling also suggested this is likely to be the disease causing variant. Interestingly, again, this family too had region of homozygosity on chromosome 22, which had this PISD gene, and the variant was shared by both the families. We went back to ask them whether they were consanguineous. They said no. And we asked whether you are related. They said no. But interestingly, they had the same surname. Then we asked them, what is your origin? Then both of them referred to a place in Maharashtra that their forefathers or ancestors came from one common region or common village in Maharashtra, which means even if you migrate, you marry, it's a person belonging to the same community, and founder effect or remote inbreeding is very, very common in our Indian population. Briefly, phosphatidyl serine decarboxylase is an enzyme which is important for synthesis of phosphatidyl ethanolamine. It is essential for phospholipid of mitochondrial membrane, and it is located in the inner mitochondrial membrane, as you see here. And disruption of PISD in mice results in early embryonic lethality. When we saw the literature, the PISD knockout mice had abnormal mitochondrial morphology. There was rounded mitochondria in PISD knockout cells as compared to the normal cells. Then we did not have facilities for function studies on this cell line then. And my colleague Kirsten Kushe and her team helped in this. We saw PISD protein was normal in patients as well as control, as you can see from figure A and B. But the mitochondria had abnormal morphology in the cells under basal conditions in patients. They also subjected the cell lines to stress by MG132, a chemical reagent, which decreased the cell viability. But if you add ethanolamine, which is required, which is an end product of this metabolism of this enzyme, it is rescued, the cells are rescued. MG132 also increases caspase levels, but again, if you treat with ethanolamine, caspase levels come down, which is a marker for cell viability and cell damage. With this, we concluded the homozygous missense variant, which is mentioned here in PASD, is associated with the novel spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia form. Patient fibroblasts show fragmented mitochondrial morphology, and induction of stress by MG132 or starosporin significantly reduces cell viability and increases activation of effector caspases in patient compared to control derived fibroblasts. Interestingly, if you add ethanolamine, it exogenously, it reduces the it improves the cellular phenotype. It is too early, but it is possible that this may be treatable by biochemical intervention. This is a very intensely competitive field. We immediately had two back-to-back publications followed by our publication, where there were three reports of patients with short stature. Some had extraskeletal features. We did not have. Some people, children had microcephaly, joint dislocation, hearing loss, retinal degeneration, and hypomyelination and ataxia. So we are yet to come out with the real phenotype of this disease, but it looks like there are diverse phenotypes attributed to mutations in this gene, not just short stature and skeletal dysplasia. It may be a multisystemic disease which goes well with mitochondrial protein coding gene genetic defects. Now the next part of my talk is on Indian contribution. I have illustrated two accounts from our team at Manipal and our collaborators till now. Now I will take you through the remainder of my talk, where we reviewed Indian contribution to rare genetic disorders with the help of my student Shruti and my colleagues Ashwin and Dalal from Hyderabad and Shubha Fadke. So this, if you are interested, you can read this paper from American Journal of Medical Genetics. Even Anik Das Bhaumik from Hyderabad has almost written similar article, but it is more extensive, taking into dissecting each and every discovery in greater detail, which is also a very nice article. So how did we do this? How did we assess Indian contribution to the disease gene discovery? I have already briefed you how it was going globally. We looked into literature where manuscripts have at least one author from an Indian institute located in India. So to call it an Indian work, the author has to be located in an institute which is located in India. We did literature survey for last 21 years, assuming that before 2000, there was no new disease gene discovered from India because the technology was not so advanced. Then what we did, we sent emails to members of Society for Indian Academy of Medical Genetics, group leaders across the country, national collaborators, clinicians and scientists who had publications in clinical genetics or medical genetics and who had discovered, to ask them what were their team's contribution and what were their friends or collaborators' contribution to disease gene discovery. So what is a new disease for this study purpose? Publication of two or more patients. So we looked into conditions where at least two or more patients with different mutations in the same gene with the similar phenotype should be described. So we wanted actually two families because that is where the condition is validated. Some people say it is better to have three, but for the purpose of this review, we selected two or more families, two or more different mutations, but all the phenotypes should be same. Or description of three or more patients from at least two different families with the same phenotype, even if the mutation is the same, like what we did before. Then if it is only a single family which is reported, it is considered publication requiring further confirmation. We did not think that it is sufficient to say this is a new disease causing gene if it is only one publication. First Indian reports of single patients, families, but confirmed by other studies were also included as disease discovered by an Indian being. So what is a new disease? I am continuing from my previous slide. Date of online publication was considered to determine the first publication, whether Indians were first or Americans or Europeans were first. So we consider date of online publication, because you know, sometimes online publication is well ahead, but your print comes a year later, so that you are at a disadvantage if you do not count them. Novel disease gene association in simultaneous publication within 1 year, because simultaneous submission may be there in different journals by two different groups, even then we consider that was the first discovery. Description of a new phenotype with a gene that is already known to be associated with another phenotype. So if it is a new phenotype associated with the same gene, we included them. A novel mechanism of disease causation. For example, if it was loss of function earlier and gain of function now, we included them. If a disease is cataloged in OMIM, then we assume that it is one of the new diseases related to a monogenic disorder. If you see the results, as of today, there are total 67 conditions reported in 65 publications, which means two of them have more than one, two each condition described. So 65 papers from India, where at least one Indian author is there, there are 67 conditions. And seven are reports of single patients, so they require further validation. So we saw autosomal dominant conditions were 13, X-linked were 3, and autosomal recessive were 51. So you can see here, I have this art is prepared by my student, which lists all the genes and all the conditions, because I thought it was extending to 7 or 8 slides. I don't know, but you can refer to the papers which I have mentioned. It is not possible to list them in this presentation. We made our best efforts, but I agree that we might have missed a few. But if somebody can tell, it will be really good, because it is not easy to make a perfect literature set. We saw the trend in publication. Probably the first disease gene discovery, it was done by probably positional cloning or linkage analysis in 2002 and 2003. Then slowly you can see the situation in India in the medical genetic field improved. 2016 saw 10 new gene disease gene discoveries with Indian contribution, and 21, we are halfway through, but we already have 12, which shows promising trend for identification of new rare diseases which are monogenic in nature. So we are improving, but this is 12, or this is 4 last year. You can see 300 were from other countries. So where India stands can be assessed by this. Recent trends and enablers of genetic gene discovery. Thanks to the vision of Professor S.S. Agarwal, Dr. I.C. Verma, and able leadership of Shubha Madam and Madhulika Kabra, and all the colleagues, clinical geneticists spread across the country, this has become easier than before. We have clinical genetics accessible to patients with rare disorder. It is still not sufficient, but we have come a long way from the situation which was there 10 years ago. We have good phenotyping skills among the clinicians, extensive national and international collaborations. We are very lucky. I think you all will agree. I think with every Indian clinical or medical geneticist, we have collaborated, and it is such a nice team working for the country and collaborating very well. Sending patients, sharing the phenotype, sharing the genetic information. So probably these are the things which contributed to accelerated pace of gene discovery. Next generation sequencing is possible in several centers and is accessible to most of the patients, either through clinical basis or through research basis. Funding situation, I am sure some, at least some of you would agree, has improved, and you could hear Dr. Shubha Phadke referring to Undiagnosed Disease Program, ICMR Function Studies Network, Virtual Center for Function Studies, Centers of Excellence, funding to sequence human genomes, Indian genomes at several places. Things are improving day by day, but we are still far from what is needed for this huge country. To summarize, most of the Indian contributions are autosomal recessive. Most of the publications have arisen from international collaborations. This is something which we need to know. because they had technical capabilities for exome sequencing, genome sequencing, and a good paper would always need good functional studies, which we are currently lacking. And not only this, why do we need international collaboration? Better cohort, larger cohort is better validation of your discovery, which you prove in more patients from more diverse background, that carries more weightage and that is more convincing, so that you don't make errors. Very few national collaborators and single center efforts were noted in this disease gene discovery, which just says all hands need to come together for better genetic discovery. Rare instances of two patients from India, which is both plus and minus. So that means, unlike European and American centers, where they hardly see one patient in the entire large set of publication, Indians have the opportunity to see two or three patients with the same disease in the same center. Okay, so this is something which is advantageous for us. Animal studies are lacking from Indian teams or Indian publications. This is what we noted widely. Modeling Drosophila or mice or earthworm or any other or lower organism for monogenic disease is some area where we need to improve further. And we need to collaborate with the clinicians and scientists to make this disease gene discovery better. In addition to this, I just wanted to reinforce a data set of normal variations is very crucial. This is just to strengthen our disease discovery. We have made a very small effort in this direction. Instead of healthy people, we took patients and we compiled data from exome data from four centers, and we made the first available data set of variants in Indian children with rare genetic diseases for the public, which is free to download for everyone. And this was possible by All India Institute of Medical Science, Gangaram, SCPJ Lucknow, CDFT, Hyderabad, and Manipal team, all coming together to contribute to disease gene discovery and a foundation for identifying new diseases, new genes, and mutations with the help of this database. I have last couple of slides left. In future, I think if there was one more East India company, they would definitely come for gene hunting or to explore the treasure of our population structure, size, and capabilities. Because loss of function variants or human knockouts are more likely to be precipitated by consanguinity. More and more extremely rare genetic disorders are likely to be seen in populations like ours. High potential for discovery of novel genes and rare diseases from India through national and international collaboration. The need of our is improved infrastructure and funding for genomic analysis. We badly need a lot of trained manpower, infrastructure, and a lot of fund to carry out. This helps both in diagnosis, which improves the family's health status, and for research. Efficient in vitro and in vivo modeling for functional validation, mainly cell lines and animals, and basic scientists coming together with the clinicians to take this forward is necessary. Increased collaboration between clinicians and scientists is probably the need of the hour. Why I am telling this is, long time ago, USA established Centers for Mendelian Genomics, which have immensely contributed for gene discovery. We have Baylor Hopkins Center for Mendelian Genetics, Broad Institute, University of Washington, and Yale University. And we have similar efforts worldwide, including the Forge Canada Consortium. So do we need Indian Center for Genomics? Probably it is time to have Indians in databases, both healthy as well as mutation databases, either local or international. It is time for us to contribute. We use NCBI databases, which is created by Americans or Europeans, but when are we contributing to this kind of database for global good? Do we really need an Indian gene matcher where Indians can show that we can probably do some better gene match and come out with good papers without the help of other countries? I don't know, but this is one thought which came across to me when I was preparing for this talk. Probably we need some efforts like indigenous. This is a word or phrase coined by Pragna with Shubha Madam. The top art show is drawn by Shubha Madam. Thank you. And it is just, and the background is Atmanirbhar Bharat. So it is like a concept where we do something for Indian genetics and discover genes, mutation. Us means all together. So it is probably something what we should work for, an indigenous approach to genomic genetic disorders. This is my last slide, but you can see there is no acknowledgement slide because I cannot fill the people who have helped me in one slide. There are innumerable teachers, colleagues, friends, students who, without any hesitation, collaborated with us to build a team, to build a vibrant education system, and collaborate with everyone. So thanks to everyone. Probably I would end up end my talk by saying Acharya Padam Adatte Padam Shishya Swamedhaya Padam Sabrahmachari Bhya Padam Kalakramenahi. Thanks for your patient listening. So thank you very much.